pintor mallorquín Pedro Darder vive a unos 4 kilómetros de Dea. Su casa, con vista sobre el mar, está rodeada de un jardín muy bello que él mismo cultiva alternándolo con la pintura. Y sobre su pintura y el cuidado de su jardín, le preguntamos: ¿puedes pintar en cualquier ambiente, en cualquier lugar?
No, necesito vivir y pintar en plena naturaleza, donde no lleguen los ruidos punzantes de la ciudad, donde las horas no se puedan contabilizar. Las semillas para germinar necesitan humedad, calor y un lugar propicio. ¿Por qué no nosotros los pintores?
¿Qué significa para ti la Costa de Dea?
Es parte de mi existencia. En principio ha sido la fuente de inspiración de la mayoría de mis cuadros.
¿Cómo distribuyes tú las horas del día?
El ritmo de mi vida es dado por la propia naturaleza. El movimiento de la luz del sol sobre los objetos indica el comienzo o el final de cada sesión. La luz central del día es poco pictórica, es blanquecina. Para aprovechar los espacios de tiempo coloristas del día, me levanto al alba y me acuesto al anochecer.
Y este jardín tuyo, tan bello, tan lleno de poesía, que tú llamas de montaña, ¿qué influencia tiene en ti?
Es parte de mi esencia. Necesito aprender de él lo que muchos, por su manera de vivir, han olvidado. Esta afición que nació en mi infancia, ahora, sin quererlo, se ha convertido en un regalo extraordinario, un escenario multicolor, tema inagotable para la creación de mis cuadros.
¿Qué te impulsa, qué te motiva a seguir pintando?
Deseo vivamente estar en contacto diario con la obra de Dios. Necesito sentirme parte integrante de la misma, pisar tierra virgen, palpar árboles y plantas, oler el aroma de las flores, escuchar el mar, los pájaros, el silencio. Necesito esconderme para una mejor comunicación con todo lo que me rodea, estar solo o bien acompañado por personas que tengan el mismo sentir.
Mark Haina, pintor de nacionalidad americana, vive y trabaja en Deia, donde llegó al final de la década de los años 50. Además de su pintura, tiene también una pasión por el cultivo de su huerta, en la cual, aunque con quejas contra las malas hierbas, trabaja con mucho entusiasmo. Aquí nos cuenta:
cuando finalmente me podía permitir de salir de los trabajos de arte aplicado de Nueva York para dedicarme enteramente a la pintura, fui a Mallorca, conocido como un paraíso ya desde mi juventud, y a ver si realmente me gustaba. Ya había viajado al Mediterráneo y lo que no quería era solamente la dulzura del Mediterráneo, del sur, las bugambillas. Estaba acostumbrado a vivir paisajes, ya parte de mi educación en juventud. Y cuando vi en Mallorca, Deia, con su fuerza de formas simples, vitales, tanto del mar que tiene un acceso desde Deia hasta las montañas, me decidí de quedarme aquí. Sí, claro, que era una escapada de la vida de la gran ciudad, la vida de la sociedad de consumo, de la vida técnica, las preocupaciones sociológicas muy vividas y muy parte de mis intereses, pero que querían evitarlos por volver al campo, volver a una educación esencialmente romántica, que era acostumbrado a vivir el paisaje, la naturaleza, las flores, las plantas. Un ideal mío siempre ha sido tener un jardín y todo esto. Y si él escapara, tenía un sentido artístico, era no solamente volver a una vida más agradable, soñada, era evolucionar en formas esenciales, en fuerzas esenciales, una arte personal que ya había sido de forma abstracta. Se ocupaba en New York parcialmente de formas y de escenas muy técnicas, muy poco amables, muy poco románticas, de las escenas del supermercado, del drugstore y todo esto. Este era un lado mío, el otro era la naturaleza y mi educación de romántico. Y cuando venía aquí, no era la belleza solo que me impresionaba, era lo esencial, la simpleza de grandes formas que me hacía entender tanto mejor, incluido gente como Gaudí, que sacaban sus influencias de las cuevas. Yo hacía siempre muchas excursiones, por mis semanas ya fui aquí a las montañas. Bueno, para volver a Gaudí, que cogía de todas estas influencias, y en mi caso quería formas fuertes de este paisaje. Y aquí creo que acelerado y simplificado mi estilo y mis fuerzas artísticas. Thank you.
William Waldron, también venido de América. Llegó aquí a mediados de los años 50. Trabajó en Deia algún tiempo como pintor, aunque en su pintura se veía claramente también al escultor. Sin embargo, hombre inquieto y de gran energía, fue el estudio de la prehistoria la que al fin le atrajo más profundamente.
I think that looking for a definition for Deia is like trying to look for the definition of art itself. One of the reasons that I left Paris was basically to get away from this idea of definition, this idea of art. And when I first came here, it was a question of trying to find what I call another medium, something that was not painting, something which was not sculpture, but something which was much more intangible. And I think that I actually have done that in my life. I think the medium, so-called medium of time, is perhaps one of the best of all mediums, as far as my expression is concerned. I feel that time is something which we have in the present, we have in the past, we have in the future. And to be concerned with prehistoric times seems to me to be the ultimate medium. Of course, you have time here. All you have to do is look around you in the mountains. The mountains are 140, 180 million years old. The stone that makes up those mountains was pushed up out of the sea. It's made up of micro-marine organisms which lived at one time, which have given us a record. And I think archaeology, in a sense, is a record of man's past, man's efforts. One gets perpetually aware of the fact that when you dig up something, you're digging up something which is 4,000 years old, or could be 30,000 years old. I have materials in the museum here that are over 30, 40, 50, 60,000 years old. I think this is, let us say, an ultimate turn-on, in a sense. It's much more, it's something which is much more magical than just painting itself. I always found painting as never having been enough. It was something which occupied a good portion of my life while I was young, and when I saw things in a different light, I found that painting was just not enough. It was something, I needed something more out of life. And Deia, in a sense, I think, taught me that. It gave me a sense of time. You look around, you see the olive trees. These olive trees, they're time itself. I mean, some of those olive trees are 700, 800, 1,000 years old. To work in that wood is an archaeological experience in itself.
Aquí, en su museo en Deia, vemos parte de los hallazgos efectuados por él y su equipo.
I think that in the long run, it's the sum result of what one does with one's life, and not so much what the little particles that one leaves in the form of works of art or a form of books, whatever you want to call them. I think that the whole sum total is made up of small, tiny particles, which, just like those mountains, are made up of small, tiny particles of what was once life, and has now left a record in the mountains themselves. I think that this is the type of thing that Deia represents to me more than anything else. I think it's time. It's something which one becomes conscious of. We know that we're leaving this world eventually, And what happens to us, in the interim is what is really important. It's not the little things that are unimportant, but the let us say the culmination or the accumulation of all these things are things which are meaningful.
Norman Jannikum. En realidad, Norman fue el primer pintor que visitamos, pues nos dijeron que estaba gravemente enfermo y que si queríamos tenerlo ante la cámara no deberíamos esperar más tiempo. Así, bajamos a su casa. Era el mes de octubre de 1987. Y, a pesar de la grave situación en que se encontraba, nos recibió con entusiasmo y con un fenomenal sentido del humor.
Now, what's that? Oh, we're talking about my coming to Dea.
Yeah.
Well, my first coming was in 1958. And since then, I've been coming every year until 1966. I'm going to come down during the summer season, 2 or 3 months. At that time, Dea was a paradise. There were not more than 20, 30 people in the whole, I mean, foreigners. People went to church those days. You see, only 3 automobiles and 2 buses. One was a Dea bus, one tourist bus. The tourist bus wouldn't stop here.
So why did you keep coming back?
I did after 1966. After 1966, I went to New York. I remained there for 6 years, and then when my pension came through, I just took the Michelangelo boat that was going to Italy. It stopped in Morocco and Casablanca. And then it came up to El Salas and into Palma, where I got off.
No. The effect of the environment?
The effect of the environment on my influence of many people in different ways. For me, I need an environment of an organic environment. Trees, flowers, even the mountain itself creates a challenge to one's unconscious in a way.
Yeah, and you said something about it helps to give birth to some creativity or
something. Well, it does. It stimulates, and that means a personal thing. What could stimulate me may not stimulate another person.
But when I first met you, what you said was the mountains and everything.
Well, the mountains, the valleys, the organic environment with it. The heck, you know.
And you why said, did you say that day is like a womb? Why
did you say? Well, day is like a womb because if you look at the sea coming into day, it's spreads like a womb. It comes in there like a womb. Which I think is the unconscious drawing power. She loves that.
Thank you.
Norman Yannicoon moría pocos meses después de haber tomado estas imágenes. George Sheridan, americano también, pintor, afincado en Deya, donde trabaja ya desde hace años. Nos recibe en uno de sus estudios, donde, entre unas tazas de café, nos cuenta de manera afable su historia.
Well, I'm very happy, Juan, to talk about Deya, because when I think back now to the early years in Paris in 1955-56, Bill Waldron, Norman Yannicoon, Michel Albert, several painters that have lived here and worked successfully here, we were all together at Paris in those years, and we used to dream about a sunny spot in the Mediterranean. And Deya is it. And we came down here 25, 30 years ago, and several of us are still living here and working here. And alas, we've just lost Norman, but Norman was a very dear friend of mine. We come from Boston together. We went to the Ecole Escuela de Belles Artes in Boston for 4 years, and then we came to Europe and lived in Paris. And I regret him very much, and hope that we can organize a large retrospective show for Norman, and I look forward to helping with that. And as for myself, I have continued to love Deya immensely. I find visually that it's still extraordinarily beautiful. It hasn't been spoiled with the inroads of time, and we hope that it continues on that way. I worry a little bit about the cost of living and the rents soaring high for the young painters that used to come here and be able to work. I hope that that will continue. Perhaps, yes, we shall see. Well, as for myself, I've always had a profound affection and love for Deya. I think one reason is because it's totally complete. It has the sea on one side and the mountains on the other. And total landscape for the artist. All the problems are there, and I hope someday to resolve them. This little sketch here is for a triptych, and my approach to landscape is to work a bit from nature and also combine it with work in the studio, where I try to simplify and clarify and arrive somehow at the emotional richness in the painting that the landscape inspired in me at the time. A curious thing happens to me is that my paintings keep growing longer and longer, and I keep extending them now. There is a precedent for this. In Paris, there's Monet in the Jeu de Paume, where he started the painting of the water lilies, and they went right round the room, and maybe that's going to be my eventual destiny. We'll see. No, but I would like to say that my affection and love for Deya continue, and I hope to celebrate this association that I have with Deya with some large landscapes and seascapes in the next couple of years, God willing. Thank you, Juan.
Muntaner. Nacido en Deià, ha pasado toda su vida entre olivos y algarrobos, como él dice, hasta que un día sintió que él podía pintar y quería pintar. Y seguramente aquel día, en Deià, nacía por primera vez en su historia un pintor de entre los algarrobos y los olivos. Toni Muntaner salió de la tierra de Deià.
Yo nací en esta finca y toda mi vida he cuidado olivos y algarrobos. Y, en fin, mi idea era de pintar y al fin lo he conseguido. Ahora he conseguido ya pintar cuadros que están bien, en fin.